We have heard a lot of stories about the impact of the internet on protest movements. We've heard a lot about the information revolution and how it's transforming countries like China, countries like Iran, even many of the countries in the former Soviet Union. And, you know, the assumption so far has been that the internet is basically a very good thing when it comes to promoting democracy. So many of these illusions were put together in the mid-90s by thinkers which I can only call cyber-utopians, people who really believed in the transformative power of the web to change societies and to change them for the better. The most famous quote was that if social networking and blogging was around in the early 90s, the genocide in Rwanda wouldn't have happened, which is now very often quoted to illustrate this very naive view that many people had back at the time. So many of the people who still believe in this really think that blogs are more or less what faxes and Xerox machines were, you know, in the late 80s, where the great dissident movements in Poland and Eastern Europe really embraced this technology. Right? So essentially, this argument is about economics and logistics. The internet and new media have made it really cheap for people to produce content, and of course, the activists and the NGOs will inevitably use this technology in order to push for reform and change, right? So, you know, if you really want to sum up this view, it basically says that if you have enough connectivity and enough devices, democracy is almost inevitable, right? And that explains why we have seen so many pushes to, you know, get China online, get Iran online, get Russia online, make sure that people have enough connectivity, make sure that people know what blogging is, make sure that people know what connectivity is, and somehow, although no one explained how exactly, these people will use these tools to ask for more democracy and, you know, collaborate together and push for more stuff. And, you know, one of the names which pundits have developed for this particular view is iPod liberalism. It's this belief that, you know, people who have iPods or any other sort of modern Western technology will also be very likely to support Western values and Western democracy, right? So the assumption here is that if you give all Chinese or Iranians or Russians, you know, enough iPods or enough laptops or enough, you know, fax machines, they will all somehow on their own aspire to democratic change, right? And of course, this would make a fascinating, you know, title for a column by Thomas Friedman, you know, drop iPods, not bombs. But, you know, this is rarely a good sign, right? It's a view which essentially disregards a lot of political, cultural, and sociological forces which are at play in the societies and embraces a very deterministic picture of the role that technology plays, right? And the main confusion here is due to the fact that we actually tend to confuse the intended uses of technology with the actual uses, right? Just like we may want to think that, you know, radio, for example, can help establish democracy in, you know, a country like the Soviet Union, which it partly did. You know, it was also used very actively during the very Rwandan genocide that, you know, we wanted to avert. We have, as I've mentioned previously, somewhat of a myth that authoritarian leaders and dictators somehow fear the internet, right? They fear technology. And again, if you really look very closely at how government leaders are trying to sort of reach out to their different netizens and, you know, and internet users, that's actually not the case. Pretty much across the board, with an exception probably of North Korea and Burma, authoritarian leaders are actually very actively engaging with technology, computers, you know, and so forth. And, you know, sometimes they do allow debate around issues which are not political. They do allow debate around some non-political issues like climate change. All of that is happening. It's just that it's not happening on issues like human rights, for example. So, and you can see, you know, there is criticism in Chinese blogs. It's actually, there is much more criticism than non-criticism, you know, and it's both of national and local governments. The question then is, why does the government tolerate it? First is to generate information that the government needs to run the country. Right? Most of these bureaucrats in the government, and in Russia, China, Iran, or elsewhere, they operate in huge information vacuum. They don't really know fully what's happening in the outer regions. So for them, having people blog and having people voluntarily provide information about what may be wrong with some local issues is actually quite helpful, because then it helps them to crack down on local corruption, misbehavior, you know, and go actually, you know, fix some of the problems which may not be political in nature, but which may help them to, you know, survive into the next, you know, century. It just helps increase legitimacy, right? So for them, sort of having this fake opening up in cyberspace is actually very useful, because it reduces tension and it convinces some people at least that, yes, they are willing to consider outside views and opinions. Some of this is happening slightly differently in other countries. So, you know, they may be still spinning it, but they're also trying to leverage the support of their users online in cyberspace, right? So, for example, in Thailand, there's a very interesting site called Protect the King, started by one of their members of parliament, which basically encourages users, you know, internet users, to go and start submitting links to websites which they may find offensive to the king. So you can basically go and nominate any of the websites that you don't like, and it will be almost within 24 hours blocked, and then you need to go through a very complex procedure to unblock it. Right, and because there are very severe, you know, less majestic laws in Thailand, you know, that works very well. Once they launch it, in 24 hours, they got like 3,000 websites blocked. Right, and there are a lot of loyalists who actually are very happy to contribute their knowledge and tips and whatnot to have those websites censored. The same is happening in Saudi Arabia, where, you know, internet users are encouraged to go and search YouTube for videos which may offend Saudi sensibilities, and then to nominate them for deletion. Right? And then if that particular video accumulates a critical mass, then YouTube will have to delete it, or will have to consider deleting it, because so many people have complained. Right? So there are organized campaigns actually to try to go and influence the decisions even of Western companies on this issue. How the Iranian authorities, after the protests, are now, you know, are slowing down, I actually looking at all of the online evidence trail left on Facebook and Twitter to actually go and start cracking down on people who were active in cyberspace, right? So now one of their initiatives now is actually putting online the pictures of protesters in the street so that they can actually be identified. So they're crowdsourcing this process of matching faces to names, right? And of course, you can guess what's going to happen once they know who, you know, the protesters were. There are a lot of dangers and fears which we do not entirely understand at this point. What we don't realize is that Twitter, despite all its virtues, it's actually a public platform, right? And if you do want to plan a revolution on Twitter, you know, your actions will be visible to everyone. In the past, you know, states used to torture to get this kind of data. I mean, now all they have to do is just to get on Facebook. Now, if you want to know how I am as an activist in a country like Belarus or Iran, I'm connected to 20,000 other activists, you know, all you have to do is go and look up my Facebook friends. My final part here would be, again, about the cyber-utopian assumption that somehow the younger generation, which has not been subject to brainwashing, which is all about digital media, mobile phones, you know, Blackberries and laptops, will somehow be prone to, you know, revolution, will be prone to embrace democratic values. The problem here is, again, that we hear quite a lot about cyber activism, right? But we hear very little about what are called cyber hedonism, right? Where the young people may not necessarily be that crazy about participating in any political action, whether it's online or offline, because of all of the good things that the internet has to offer. Adult content, which is pornography, you know, and instant messaging and email, still occupies proportionally much more space than politics or news, right? And again, we have to keep that in perspective, that most of what young people do online revolves around, you know, them communicating to each other or downloading entertainment, right? And it's not at all clear how they will advance to this level of actually being politically active. What if it wouldn't get them onto the streets? And that's something which we don't see discussed very often. You know, we hear a lot about this distinction between digital natives and digital, you know, immigrants. What we don't hear about is distinction between digital renegades and digital captives, which I think is a much more important one, because we need to know how exactly technology influences their, you know, civic engagement and their propensity to actually go and engage in protest. We have to go back to Maslow and actually start thinking about how this, you know, pyramid of needs can actually be applied to cyberspace. And it may as well be that when you are coming, you know, when you are bringing internet to China, Russia, or Iran, at the very beginning, what people would want to do online is, you know, have fun, you know, explore pornography or YouTube or videos of fighting cats and move on to talking and sharing. Some may want to go and explore learning. Eventually, they may want to campaign. Some of them will go and start downloading reports from Human Rights Watch, but most of them will still be downloading pornography. And that's a very important perspective to keep in mind. And if we really want to understand the actual net impact and net effect of technology on, you know, society, they have to look much broader and factor in the negative consequences as well.